Thank you. Please stand for our call to worship. I lift my eyes to the hills, where does my help come from?
My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
Let us join together in our opening hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness, number 276.
Resurrection of the body and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. Well, it's good to see y'all on a beautiful day. I woke up and saw a snowflake on my weather on my phone. It didn't happen. It's warming up. It's nice. I think the cold front's coming later today. But by then, you'll have a pot of chili, hot wings, and a Super Bowl on. So it won't matter. How many are Bengals fans? A few. How many? Who's it ranked? Not the Falcons. I know that. The Rams. Rest. Matthew Stafford reason. There you go. All right. Well, I kind of like an underdog, but it should be fun. And when you don't really have a dog, so to speak, in that fight, it's easier to watch and enjoy anyways.
We have three dogs in that fight.
That's right. The coach of the Rams, right?
Three. He graduated
first. Did he really? So who's the other side? Okay. There you go. So Georgia is influencing the world, so and the Braves start spring training next week, so we'll be good. Hope you enjoy the day. I hope the commercials are better than last year. They were not real good last year. I'm not real sure about the halftime show. We'll just see what happens. We'll see what happens. All respect to Dr. Dre, just not my genre of music. Just a couple of announcements to highlight. The beautiful flowers today are given by Sharon Grice in memory of her father, so thank you, Sharon. If you would like to give flowers on a special Sunday of the year, men, hint, anniversary, nice, easy way to get a lot of points. The sign-up sheet's out here in the hallway, and you can sign up for all of 2022 whenever you would like to. During this service today, we'll have ordination and installation of some more of our elders, and we'll have one more Sunday later. Vicki Hare had knee replacement surgery about 10 days ago, and unfortunately she's got a little bit of an infection in that new knee, and being out, being here, let alone kneeling, were not options. So we'll do a makeup, a rain delay type of one for her a little bit later in prayers as she starts to feel better. We also have our annual congregational meeting following the service. It shouldn't be too long. We'll present not only the annual report of 2021, but also provide for your information the budget for 2022. Also an exciting report from the building committee, and I hope that you can stay for that. It should be 20 minutes so. I'm going to do my best to have a short sermon, I promise. And we're going to televise all, that's not the right word even anymore. We're streaming this service, and we have a lot of folks who are home that are watching. We wanted to be sure we would be streaming the congregational meeting as well, and we will do that all the way through the end of the service. And as I look right now, it's working, so hi, Mom. hopefully it will keep working. Chancel Choir returns this week to rehearsal, so we look forward to having them back in the sanctuary the first Sunday of March. Next Sunday, the Raven Gap Nakuchi Choir will be with us. They joined us back in the fall. They're coming back to join us next Sunday. We'll look forward to special music from them and at the 11 o'clock service. We'll continue with two services for the foreseeable future, and excited to do that. And the 9 o'clock folks are getting acclimated. They're not even bringing blankets. They just like it, 35 degrees in here. It's working out really well. If you haven't had a chance to look, we have broken ground. There is the smell of fresh dirt. Look between the barns. If you have an all-wheel drive vehicle, you can even drive beside the big barn and go and get a better look of our 2.59 acres that we bought last fall from the school. And it is being cleared. It'll be very cleared this week. Some big trees coming down and piled up, and the brush is gone. It already looks so good, and that is a beautiful piece of land. You will look to the left and look all the way up Betty's Creek and see Pickens Nose, and I can just see sunsets. After we get the sanctuary built and this remodeled, we'll have to build us a big pavilion back there so that we can have some family nights and fifth Sunday services outdoors, and have a big pavilion in that beautiful area. You can even get down to the creek if you got a fishing permit. You could probably drop a fly in there and catch something. You'll hear the roar of Betty's Creek and the roar of tractor trailers on 441. It's very soothing, and you will enjoy it very much. It is beautiful, and excited to smell dirt and to see progress being happened. We have a meeting this week with contractors, architects, and suppliers, and building committee meets this week. And we are starting to, having been at the starting line for what seems like an eternity with COVID, we are ready to press go and get going. Just a couple of other things to highlight. Bible studies are Zoom, Psalm 120 through 127. And I think that is everything. If you did not get an annual report when you came in the door, Steve's going to be handing them out after the service for the meeting. These are available for you. They will tell you a lot of great information. We had an amazing year last year before you even consider a pandemic and not even worshiping together till Easter. Truly, what an amazing thing God has done in our congregation and our life of our church. On the back page is something that I am just astounded by, because for so many years, our value of our monthly food distribution annually was right at about $1 million. 2 years ago, we went to a tractor trailer size load, which was less expensive in our cost from the food bank, but it went from 10,000 plus about 6,000 pounds of supplemental food we were ordering to a flat load of 40,000 pounds each month. Well, in 2022, the retail value of 837,486 pounds of food, which we distributed, serving 1,621 families, 4,241 individuals, the retail estimated value, and it's a low, like $1.78 a pound is what they base that on, $3,308,070. More than 10 times our church's annual budget, we are able, through partnership with the food bank, good stewardship of our funds, and the sweat and work ethic of all of you to be here, we have been able to provide in 2021 697,905 meals based on 1.2 pounds of food equal a meal. 58,158 meals a month, 13,421 meals a week. Every day in Raven County, 1,912 people have supper because of this church. So God bless all of you for your great work and support of the food ministry here at Raven Gap Presbyterian Church. I do want to, before I turn you loose in the children's sermon, I got a note that today is John Harrison's birthday and tomorrow is Pam's birthday. So not only are they from Bacon and Coffee County, side by side, their birthdays are side by side. So happy birthday to both of you, and congratulations. Happy birthday. As our children come forward for our children's message, if you will, quickly wave at those around you. But I will be honest, they're not scratch biscuits, they're frozen biscuits, which nowadays are not bad. They're pretty good, and I know there's a few people that are still fans of canned biscuits, I don't know why, but I'm sure some of you like the sound of that can popping on the counter. These are Mrs. B's little tea biscuits, and they're about as close to homemade as you can. And I have biscuits because we're talking about the Lord's Prayer today in the Sermon on the Mount. In the Lord's Prayer, it says, give us this day our daily bread. So biscuits are the ultimate type of bread, basically. But I want to talk about prayer a little bit. And my mom and dad are watching. So we're going to see how this goes. I may have a text before the service ends. But growing up, my dad is a minister, was a minister. And after church on Sundays, we would go out to eat. And my biggest memory of going out to eat after church was when we lived in Orlando. We lived in Orlando when I was in second grade through sixth grade. So, 7 years old till 12 years old, with a little break in between, we went to Missouri. But we would, like, if things were really good and we behaved and church was great, we'd go out to eat at Red Lobster, which started in, like, Orlando, Florida, or close by, or Gary's Duck Inn. Any of our Floridians in Orlando remember Gary's Duck Inn, which was the pre-Red Lobster. It's like where the idea of Red Lobster came from. And, you know, we'd get there to eat, and my dad was a minister. So we'd have to have a blessing, which we all should have a blessing. But my dad would, like, bless it. I mean, like, bless it, like, preacher bless it. Like, my friends were in the restaurant sometimes, and my dad would be like, let us pray. Dear God. And at second grade, it was kind of interesting. By about sixth grade, you're like, oh, my gosh, why is he doing this? It's so embarrassing. And I remember finally getting the courage up to say to my dad, you know, can we just... You know, there's that part where Jesus says you should pray in your room and not do it so everybody can be seen. And he didn't like that I used the Bible against him. That was not good. And right away he said to me, are you ashamed of Jesus? I was like, no, it's you. By the time I was about 13 or 14, I came up with this idea to pray in a more discreet way, a Presbyterian way. When you sit down at the table, you should put your napkin on your leg. We're class, not trash. We know how to have manners. You put your napkin on your leg, and just before the food comes, you knock it off, and you bend down under the table, and you go, amen. Nobody has to know. Well, I've grown in my faith, and I've matured in my life, and I've realized my dad was really right. And I really love to see people pray. In fact, in a non-COVID world, when I get to eat out with y'all, everybody's always like, Don, will you bless it? I'm like, you do it. And then I can watch people go, ha. Oh. I like to hear people pray. I like to hear what your prayer is, be it the same prayer every meal or a special prayer every meal. In fact, Mrs. Barber doesn't like this, but back before COVID, when we went out to eat in places other than drive-thrus, if I saw somebody praying for their meal, I'd go by and say, I appreciate your witness, because that's a very unique, powerful witness to a room full of people that may not have given God a thought that day. And just to quietly bow your head, to give thanks, and then to eat your meal. Now, you know, we have ruled at Mexican restaurants, chips and salsa do not require prayer. After the chips and salsa is when you should bow your head and say your prayer. So today we're going to learn about how Jesus taught us to pray. And Jesus said, when you pray, pray like this. And he gave us this great, great word. He says to us, our Father, the Lord's Prayer. And you know, in the history of all the people that ever lived, no one ever called God Daddy until Jesus, because he's family. Let us pray. Lord, we give you thanks for our daily bread, for your daily care and love. Help us to pray always in the way that you taught us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you. I'm just going to say, that felt like Raven Gap pre-COVID. That was fun. Instead of a normal pastoral prayer, I want to share some prayers this week upcoming. Susan Gilliam's having a procedure on Monday and Tuesday, Valentine's, and they are working to fix a slightly irregular heart. Not a broken heart, but an irregular heart. So we want to keep her in our prayers, and Steve as well. Steve Perry's having a second opinion consultation this week. We'll keep him in our prayers. John Harrison's having a procedure this week. The Kerrigans, Jim, Ann, and Ann's mother, Laura Harvey, are all battling COVID, and Jim has been taken to the hospital Friday and not doing well. Prayers for the Kerrigan family. Carol Hoffman's having whichever eye she didn't just have done. And Richard Hoffman, her husband, her beloved husband, our friend, his brother passed away in Brazil on Friday. So prayers for him as well. At the early service, my friend Howard and Becky Young were at the service, and they told me afterwards that Jane is in the hospital. I went in for something with her leg, an infection, and tested positive. So she's in an isolation room, she said, and just bored to death, but she's feeling fine. I talked to her between the services, and she said, "Who told?" And I said, "It was Howard." And she said, "I know, he called. He said the sermon was really good. Your people are so fortunate." I said, "Thank you." He didn't say that. I added that part. Y'all would be excited about the sermon. So instead of a normal pastoral prayer, keep all of those folks in your private prayers this week. But let's pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Let's pray it just a little slower. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us now bring to God his tithes and our offerings. And Mark is going to sing you the great arrangement by Malott of the Lord's Prayer.
Thank you.
give you thanks for all the blessings you have bestowed upon us, and we give you thanks for the opportunity to return to you a portion of all that you have blessed us with for the service of the kingdom, to further the gospel, to proclaim the good news. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 6th chapter, beginning with verse 5. Listen for God's word. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogue and on the street corners to be seen by others. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full, but when you pray, go into your room and close the door and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This, then, is how you should pray. Our Father, in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. A little short passage of scripture, bookend in the dead center of the Sermon on the Mount. Amazing things before, amazing things after, and right here in the middle of this 6.5 minute long sermon that changes the world, Jesus talks about prayer. Not only about prayer, but tells us how we should pray and what we should pray. Jesus gives us instruction on both. I love to hear people pray. I love to hear other people pray. Now, as a minister, there is kind of this default thing that if I'm in the room right away, well, Don, will you say grace? Will you bless this? And I'm fine with that. I'm great with that. But I like to hear you pray. I like to hear other people's prayers. I will never forget being at the Clayton Cafe, the old Clayton Cafe, the original Clayton Cafe. You know, they had the weather rock there behind the cashier that would tell you if the rock is moving, it's windy. If the rock is wet, it's raining. It was very high-tech and sophisticated. On a Saturday morning, as Cheryl and I sat there, in came Coach Dan Reeves and his family and grandchildren, got the corner booth in the window, and before the pancakes came, soon as they placed the order, he said, "All right, let's pray." And he prayed a beautiful, wonderful prayer in a big-time preacher meets football coach voice. I like to hear people's prayers. And it's an important part of life to see people pray. It is a simple, quiet, and beautiful witness. And I have learned to pray at dinners and special functions. I have realized when the Chamber of Commerce asks me and not the Baptist minister, that means there's a bar somewhere in the building. Us Presbyterians, you know, we invented golf and this stuff called scotch, so I get invited to certain parties that my Baptist brothers do not. I have learned in the time of COVID to not only pray at hospitals, in hospitals, but outside of hospitals, beside hospitals, in parking lots, and now I've gotten comfortable praying via Zoom and FaceTime. It's a different time and a different day. Lunch or dinner with you all is a special, beautiful moment pre-COVID, and I look forward to post-COVID, because that is that moment when the preacher's in your house and we all say grace, and I do my best to defer to hear your words, your blessing, your prayer. It's honest, it's real, it's authentic, and it's powerful to me. I remember Cheryl taught a newlyweds engaged class. One of the books we were using had this crazy idea that husbands and wives should pray together. I live in a house with a wife and three girls. The only time I wasn't together was when I was praying. That's the only sort of tidbit, scrap of privacy I had. That's my most intimate, private time. And Cheryl said, we ought to do that. We ought to pray together. And I was like, yeah, okay. And we kind of knelt down, and she looked at me, and I looked at her, and I said, you go first. And she started praying. She prayed a beautiful prayer, and then I started to pray, and I stopped. I went, busted. I realized for many years I had not been praying for her. I had been praying against her. God, if you'd only make Cheryl stop doing, God, please help Cheryl too. And when she was right beside me, I couldn't say it out loud, because that was bad, that was evil, that was wrong. No matter how sincere I thought I was at the time, it wasn't appropriate, and I had to learn to pray different. I needed to pray for her, to celebrate, to ask God's blessings upon her. Well, Cheryl and I were flipping through TV, and if you're like us, there is nothing good on television, nothing good on Amazon, nothing good. Well, that Clarkson's Farm is pretty good on Amazon, and I kind of like that whole grand tour thing, and Netflix doesn't have anything I care about, and Hallmark, I've seen them. I mean, whether I've seen them all. I know how the story goes. Cheryl even is honest. I'm like, have you not seen this one? She said, let's be honest, I know the story. And I said, yeah. We're flipping through. Oh, and tonight, Round the World in 80 Days, and All Creatures Great and Small on GPB, PBS. If you have not watched those, worth watching. Great television. You will go to bed peaceful, happy, and tranquil. We were flipping through this week, and somehow there was nothing on, and wound up on Netflix, and what was trending was some movie that I am not endorsing or recommending. There is some inappropriate language and content, but it's apparently nominated for an Oscar, which just tells you that, you know, a made-for-TV movie is now up for an Oscar. That's just how bad those awards have gotten. But it had an A-list of characters and actors playing in it, and it was called Don't Look Up. Any of you seen this interesting film? Satire slash comedy slash end of the world Armageddon. The astronomy PhD candidate is looking through the telescope and spots this new meteor, and discovers it, and the little group gets together with the professor and does the calculations, and the calculations get closer to 0000. All of a sudden they're like, what does that mean? And he says, we'll think about it, I'm tired. Calls back the one that founds it. It's going to be a direct hit on the world. A 5 to 10 kilometer meteor, an extinction event, to destroy everything. With that, they call NASA. NASA's like, what? And they do the calculate, yes, and then they get this appointment at the White House, and this, and I mean this in all due respect, sort of, I guess, that the president is Meryl Streep, which of course, you know, why not? I mean, she's Meryl Streep. But she plays kind of this unique character that would be the love child of Donald Trump and Sarah Palin, maybe? Interesting character. She's kind of a little narcissistic. She has this meeting with him. She's like, I hear there's something y'all are concerned about. They tell him this meteor is going to wipe out the world. And she said, well, you know, you think it will. You know, maybe it won't. She said, well, you know, we're 99.98% sure it will. She said, oh, well, you're saying we have a chance. Not really, but it's midterm elections and the spin. And her son is the chief of staff, and he's just not worth anything, but I'm not making any commentary. This is just a movie. And anyways, they get kind of pushed aside. The administration doesn't want its word out because this could disrupt the midterms and the economy and all these things. So they kind of go outside of the rules, and they appear on like the Today Show with this really kind of insipid, really silly set of hosts that are all about fluff and laughing. And all of a sudden the PhD student loses it. She says, "Don't you understand? We're all going to die." The FBI takes them, this, all that. There's all sorts of interesting things and moments. 6 months. 6 months for the world to repair. 6 months for the world to try to come up with a plan to bust up the meteor. The government fails in their plan. They call it back because the polling numbers show that people don't think it's really going to happen. So they pull back all the rocket ships and the nukes. The Russians and the Chinese try it on their own. They kind of blow up on the ground. They don't do a good job because their technology failed. There's kind of a Steve Jobs character who realizes that the meteor has valuable rare earth materials that, you know, while it would destroy the earth, if we break it into all these pieces, we would have $370 trillion worth of rare earth materials that are needed for tech. And so that becomes the plan. His stuff doesn't work. All of his tech fails. Anyways, the scientist, the astronomer, has made a bad decision. He has cheated on his wife. Everybody messes up. Everybody has sins and blood on their hands. In the last moments before the meteor's coming, the scientist has gone back to his hometown and where he teaches at Michigan State. The PhD student and a new little boyfriend that she's met that's pretty much a loser, just a skateboarder, hanging outside the convenience store kind of guy. But hey, it's the end of the world. Who cares, she says. They gather together, and he goes to his house after being at the grocery store where people have rampaged and pulled everything. Nobody's there. Everybody's left their work and gone home because the end of the world is about to happen. And this group of kind of family and tag-along family starts making dinner. And they gather around the table, and in that it's kind of like it's a holiday meal, and you're realizing it's sort of a Thanksgiving for the life they had, and then you realize, no, surely the director isn't kind of doing a parallel of this is like a Last Supper, but it is literally their Last Supper. The point of impact is just moments away. And as they sit down and get ready to pass the food and eat, the professor, the astronomer, says, "You know, I feel like we kind of ought to have a prayer, but I'm not a religious person, but I think somehow we ought to at least say amen for everything we've experienced." The little skater boy, he says earlier in the film that he wondered what God's plan was in the meteor, and the PhD candidate says, you're religious? He says, "Yeah, I grew up in a Christian home, very evangelical. Don't tell anybody." But at this moment at the table, this little skater guy, Timothy Chalamet, I think is the actor's name, he goes, "I got this." He puts his hands up, and one by one, they each grab hands to pray, not like around this way, but like up in the air, and they're all holding hands. And this is what he prays in this film. "Dearest Father and Almighty Creator, we ask for your grace tonight despite our pride, your forgiveness despite our doubt. Most of all, Lord, we ask for your love to soothe us through these dark times. May we face whatever is to come in your divine will with the courage and open hearts of acceptance. Amen." Not a movie I'm recommending, but a movie worth watching to hear that prayer before the house blows up and the world goes dark. How we pray and what we pray is the focus of the most important moment in the Sermon on the Mount. Each and every week, more than 2 billion people at some point in worship or in their private lives say the Lord's Prayer. I love to hear people pray, and I love at weddings and funerals because that's a time when many folks who are not churched or not regularly in church show up. And there is that moment, and I print in every service in celebration of the resurrection, in other words, in every memorial or funeral service, and in every wedding, the Lord's Prayer. And I print it with debts and debtors, because we're Presbyterians, and we say debts and debtors. And when you get to the prayer, everybody goes into that, whatever they heard, and you hear this, I go, debts, and they go, trespasses, and then the next time, they aren't sure what to say, and it's kind of like, trespasses. And at the end, I kind of giggle and laugh, and I say, you know, I can tell who the Presbyterians are, and everybody laughs. Even at a funeral, they laugh. And then I say, and for the record, we're right, and the rest of the Christian world is wrong. And that's true. We are right, and the rest of the Christian world is wrong. The literal text says debts and debtors. It was Tyndall who changed that in his translation, and then his translation was picked up in, I think, the Anglican prayer book of 1545-ish or something. And with that, everybody but the Presbyterians went to trespasses, and we stuck with debts and debtors. And we're right, and the rest of the Christian world is wrong. Now, when I went to Peachtree Pres, I was shocked. I was dismayed, because the first time I assisted in worship, they didn't say debts and debtors. And they didn't say trespasses. They said sins and those who have sinned against us. Now, I couldn't quite get my head around it. I had to have it written down. I had to just really try to get in that mode. And I finally got the courage up to ask Dr. Harrington about it and said, you know, why don't we use debts and debtors? That's Presbyterian, and we're right. It's in the text. Jesus said debts and debtors. Why? He said, well, we have a very affluent congregation. Some of our folks have no debt. Some of our folks' homes are paid for. Their cars are paid in cash. They do not carry a balance on the American Express card. I said, okay. I said, why not trespasses? He said, oh, that's an easier one to dismiss. I've never been on anybody's property that was posted, do not trespass. I was like, okay. He cocked his glasses in his head. He said, but when you say sins, they all know they're guilty. He was right. My father always said, prayer is a two-way conversation. We talk to God, and God talks with us. I find all too often for myself, and maybe you as well see this and recognize it, we all too often rush through our prayers. We check the box as fast as we can. And we don't give time or space to listen for God's reply, for God's words to us, for heaven's side of the conversation. We're so busy saying, I want, I need help, that we don't listen or expect an answer. A long time ago, about 26 years ago, when I was a summer of my first year of seminary and working as a youth director at Covenant Presbyterian Church in Atlanta, right there at Peachtree Battle, more importantly, just up the hill from Jalisco's Mexican restaurant. Steve Goyer and the session at that time, and I try to remember Randall, had a great young guy in the church who is an actor that you all know and have seen because he does the denture commercials, the affordable denture commercials. Randall Taylor. Randall knew these friends from the theatrical world and asked them to come, and it was a Christian theatrical group out of Cincinnati, Ohio, by the name of Friends of the Groom. See, Friends of the Groom, you know, the Christ is the bridegroom. You, as Christian, should be a friend of the groom. Tom S. Long in 1982 wrote this play, and it's different. It's different for a sermon. But I ordered the play from them years ago. I talked with them this week about what is it to use in worship, that I would like to use it in my sermon. I guess I'm sort of performing it in a way, not as good as they do, but as best I can. And of all Sundays, our award-winning actress, Jessie, comes to church. So here I go, off the deep end, off the high dive. They said I could use it, and with that, I said, but we're going to be streaming the service, so is there an issue of royalties and all that? And they said, yes, there is, and you do need to send a check for the royalties. Tom wrote this, and it is a part of Friends of the Groom. It was originally adapted for, with permission from If God Talked Out Loud by Clyde Lee Herring. The royalties are $15, and we'll get the check in the mail. Thanks to Tom Long for this wonderful play. I need to set this play up. Years ago here, we sort of did it one Sunday, maybe my first year at Raven Gap. Now I'm in my 18th year, so most of you don't remember it or were not here. This is a person praying the Lord's Prayer. Now, if I were Friends of the Groom, one person would come out on stage, the lights would dim, a spotlight, and he or she would begin to pray the Lord's Prayer. And throughout the prayer, there is a conversation. There is an interruption. There are interjections by our Father, God, punctuating the prayer, the Lord's Prayer. I think what's so unique about it is after seeing that play long ago at Covenant Presbyterian Church, I've never thought about the Lord's Prayer the same way again. And my hope is for you, it will be the same. I'm going to do my best to look this way for the voice of God and this way for the voice of Don, who is the character praying the prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, yes? What is it? Please, I'm trying to pray here. Do you mind? Oh. Our Father, who art in heaven. Hello. I'm here. Do you mind? I mean, could you wait till I'm done? I'm trying to pray here. You called me. I did. Yes, you said, Our Father who art in heaven. Never mind. I was just reciting the Lord's Prayer. And I was just answering. Oh. Go ahead, I'm listening. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. You really think so? Think what? That my name is hallowed. Hallowed? Yes, you know, holy. Do you respect my name? Well, yeah, I guess I do. How about yesterday on your way to work when you got behind that slow bus? I didn't mean what I said. Well, let me ask you, how would you like it if everybody went around shouting, Oh, Don, every time they hit their thumb with a hammer and got held up in traffic? Sorry. I forgive you. Look, this is going to take forever. Why don't we do this some other time? I mean, you're busy, I'm busy, you're interrupting. Would that be so bad? What? Talking with me forever? I don't know. I never really thought about it like that. Will do. It might just happen. Go ahead. Keep going. All right. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Whoa, right there. You sure you want all of that? All of what? My kingdom coming, my will being done? Well, actually, I kind of would like a little bit of more of that heaven on earth part. We could use a little more heaven down here. So, what are you doing about it? Me? You want my will done? Who do you expect to do it? Well, I thought since it's your kingdom, I mean, can't have a kingdom without subjects, can you? No, I guess not. Hey, it's not that hard. All you really have to do is love me with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Oh, brother. Him too. Look, can we just get on with this? Sure, don't let me stop you. Right, okay. I forgot where I was. Give us this day. Oh, yeah. I got it. Give us this day our daily bread. You know, you could use a little less bread, actually. Oh, man, come on. No, really. Really, you know half my people eat less meat in a year than you have for breakfast. Picky, picky, picky. You want me to do what's best for you, don't you? All I asked for was a little bread. And today, the bread that I'm giving you is a half hour of Bible study, a free evening spent with your family, and a $20 deduction from your checking account for the World Hunger Charity of your choice. All that. Just for me, thanks. Just for you. You really shouldn't have. Hey, I like to give you good things. Thanks a lot. Come on now, on with the rest of the prayer. Hey, look, this is really kind of dragging on. It's kind of getting long. Why don't we just take a break right here? Now, Don, there's not that much more. I'd really rather stop. Don? Okay. Forgive us our debts as we forgive those who trespass against us. Mm-hmm. What about Jerry? I knew you were going to bring him up. I knew you were going to say that from the start. Well, look, after all the things he's done to me, you expect me to just forget about it? I don't know. How do you want your forgiveness? With or without forgetting? Oh, come on. You know he's not the least bit sorry, and he treats me like that all the time. I mean, enough is enough. Whatever you say. What do you mean, whatever I say? Well, it's up to you. Right now, I'll forgive you for everything as long as it's not a repeated offense and you apologize first. What? As you forgive, so you are forgiven. You said it. It's in the prayer. Oh. What do you think? I don't know. I can try to forgive him, but what if I just can't pull it off? I'll tell you what. You do your best, and I'll do mine. Okay. And don't worry. My best is pretty good. Yeah. And just a little bit more. Just a little bit more. Let's finish the prayer. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Hey, wait a minute. You know, I always wondered about that. It's kind of strange to put that in the prayer. I mean, you're not going to lead me into sin, are you? I don't know. You spend half your time asking me to do just that. Well, what do you mean? Look, you love being tempted. You're always hoping I'll arrange things so you'll be helpless in the face of passion beyond your control. Well, maybe once in a while. I mean, I wouldn't mind a little excitement, but Don, if you can honestly ask me not to lead you into temptation, maybe, just maybe, that means you're halfway resolved to avoid it yourself. All right, you got me again. I mean, it seems like every time I open my mouth, there's something else you want me to change. Sometimes you expect more out of your immediate family. Come on now, time for the big finish. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Don, do you know what I would really like and what would really give me glory? I am so afraid to ask. Just keep talking to me, okay? Yeah, I guess I can manage that. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We have a big day today with not only our regular worship, but the ordination and installation of our new class of elders and two elders that came on during COVID and we were not able to ordain and install. So I'm going to ask them to come forward. We have Kira Kina, Alan Lancaster, and Melissa Stockwell. If you will join me right here. Lisa and Carrie are both being ordained and installed. Alan has served previously on the session, and he is being installed to serve again actively on the session. As they have studied and prepared for this day, they've been reading many great sources on being an elder and what that means. They are going to serve as pastors in this congregation. Elders in our tradition, we believe in the priesthood of all believers, and with that, the elders in the church come in sort of two packages. There are teaching elders like myself, and then there are ruling elders like they are. And we are equal in our call to ministry, our service to Christ, our compassion and care for the congregation. So I will begin our ordination and installation with a word of prayer. Our clerk is in the back. Let us pray. Holy, loving God, we give thanks. We give thanks for these wonderful people that you have knitted together in their mother's wombs and brought them to this place and this time to serve Christ and to represent all that is good. We ask your blessings upon not only their lives and their families, but their service to this church and the greater church in the world. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. The constitutional questions for elders I will ask you now, and if you so believe in your heart, say, I do or I will. And you know what? The CDC may write me a letter. We need to see y'all because I'm sure you got family and friends watching and it's okay. I've had two shots, a booster and COVID. Do you trust in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and acknowledge him Lord of all and head of the church and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? If so, say, I do. Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testament to be by the Holy Spirit the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the Church Universal and God's Word to you? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Do you sincerely adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Will you fulfill your ministry in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? If so, say, I will.
I will.
Will you be governed by our church's polity? Will you abide by its discipline?
Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? If so, say, I will. Will you in your own life seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? If so, say, I will. Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? If so, say, I do. Will you pray for and seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? If so, say, I will. Will you be a faithful ruling elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in councils of the church, and in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? If so, say, I will. These are awesome vows of ordination. And with that, they do not make these vows alone, but you, the members of the congregation, join in this covenant commitment to lead our church as elders and to serve faithfully as members. So I ask you now, the members of this church, Raven Gap Presbyterian Church, and any Christian church, do you accept Alan Lancaster, Carrie Keena, and Melissa Stockel as your ruling elders, chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? If so, say, we do. Do you agree to pray for them, to encourage them, to respect their decisions, and to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is head of the church? If so, say, we do. Now, Alan has been ordained previously, so he has now been installed, but Carrie and Melissa are first-time elders, so we will have a time of prayer and the service of ordination for them. So I'm going to ask Carrie first. And any elder in this church or any Christian church, if you would please come forward as we lay hands upon her and pray as she becomes a new elder. Kneeling okay? You good? At our church, knees are questionable. It's always a fair question to ask. Carrie Keena, child of God, we pray in God's mighty name for your continued wisdom and guidance through the Spirit and through Scripture to faithfully live and serve in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray for your leadership in this church, for your joy, for your ever-present smile, your wisdom that comes from the classroom as a teacher, that you will teach us new and wondrous things about how you see and know God. We give thanks for your life, for your family, for your work and your witness. And we ordain you now in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We pray this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
You can air hug and high five in whatever your comfortable COVID-friendly way. Melissa? Knees good?
Yes.
Holy and loving God, we pray and give thanks for Melissa's life, her work, her witness. Again, a wonderful elder that you have brought to us from the classroom who brings wisdom and experience, and a new track coach to teach us the importance of finishing the race in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we give thanks for Melissa's love of music, love of this church, love of this community, and most importantly, her love of Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. We ask your blessings upon her. May we treat her with respect and listen to all of our elders as they provide guidance and wisdom to us as we move forward together in this great church, in this great place we call home. Lord, we ask your blessings upon Melissa's family, her friends, her students, and her track athletes. We pray this and we ordain her in the wondrous name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So be it forevermore. Amen. It would be appropriate to applaud.
Our closing hymn is the first verse of Christ Is Made the Sure Foundation. If you're unable to stay for our meeting, which I don't expect to be, but just about 20 minutes or so, if you would like to leave during the singing of this first verse of Christ Is Made the Sure Foundation, now is your chance. Let us stand together.